of important as per the, your exam point of view, I have selected four topics. So the morbidity caused by tobacco smoke and ethanol abuse and lead poisoning and ionizing radiation. So what is environmental disease? It refers to conditions. They are caused by exposure to either chemical or physical agents that can be in the air or in our environment and the workplace or our personal environment, including diseases of nutritional origin. Okay. These diseases of nutritional origin, you have the protein, energy, malnutrition, all vitamin deficiencies, as well as pathology of obesity. And all nutritional disorders from your school and in physiology also you would have read. So you can just go through that. But this physical agents I am touching upon. So what is that tobacco? Hazards of tobacco. It can be a smoking tobacco or smokeless tobacco. So smoking, all of you know, it is cigarettes, cigars, pipes. And smokeless are snuffs and chewing. So in India, the most common one used is BDs, followed by cigarettes, and then including the little bit of the other one, chewing, pan masala, gutkha, all those things. So tobacco contains about 7,000 chemicals, and among them 60 are carcinogens, and it is one of the preventable human cause of death. And it is most common cause of human cancers. And 90% of the lung cancers, there is a history of tobacco intake in any one of the form. And it causes about 8 million deaths per year by 2020. And about 500 million deaths will occur in those people who are consuming tobacco and who are alive today. So in US, it's declining, and in China, they are the main people who produce tobacco as well as consume tobacco, followed by India. And smokeless tobacco causes mainly diseases of the oral cavity. You have mainly the squamous cell carcinoma of the cheek. So what are the adverse effects of tobacco? They are classified into non-neoplastic disorders and neoplastic disorders. Among the non-neoplastic disorders, coronary heart disease is the topmost, most common cause, because it produces atherosclerosis, and that is the deposit in the vascular system, and that causes thromboembolism, causing coronary heart disease. Okay. Second is COPD. COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. There are four conditions: bronchial asthma, emphysema, chronic bronchitis, and bronchiectasis. And third is cerebrovascular accident. That is again due to atherosclerosis, causing thromboembolic phenomena. And peptic ulcer, because of the irritant effect of the tobacco, and early menopause, as well as intrauterine growth retardation, that we'll come to. Neoplastics, all of you know, CA lung predominates, followed by cancer of upper aerodigestive tract, pharynx, larynx, esophagus, etc. Then pancreas and kidney, because some of the metabolites are excreted in the kidney and via the urinary bladder because of that. So what are the carcinogens? It can be a promoter or an initiator. And the carcinogenesis is caused by tar, the benzopyrene, polycyclic. This is more very, you must remember this. Polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons and nitrosamines. these two you have to remember, they are initiators of carcinogenesis. The promoters are nicotine and phenol. And irritation and toxicity. What does irritation cause? So chronic irritation causes inflammation repair that leads to metaplasia, dysplasia, and then carcinogenesis. Formaldehyde, nitrogen oxide. These are all present in the tobacco. And reduced oxygen transport because of the carbon monoxide that is present. So in the hemoglobin, there are more of carbon monoxide that reduces hypoxia. So what does we, many people think that nicotine is the main carcinogen, because of nicotine, people are getting CLL. That is not so. It is a tumor promoter, but it is a main addictive function. Okay, the addiction is due to nicotine. So it is alkaloid, it is present in the tobacco leaf. How it causes addiction is, it binds to the nicotinic acetylcholine receptors in the brain. Because of that, it causes addictive effect. Second is, when a person smokes, they get a feeling of well-being. That is because the catecholamines are released because of this receptor and because of the nicotine. So these people get increased heart rate, increased blood pressure, and a sense of well-being. So because of this, acute effect is due to the catecholamines that are released by the nicotine. And it also affects fetal brain development when the mother smokes, and also causes preterm as well as stillbirth. So these are many chemicals that are present within the ammonia, nicotine, toluene, and they are present in toilet cleaner, paint, then rocket fuel, all those things. Arsenic is there, methane, acetic acid, butane, cadmium, and stearic acid. All these chemicals are present. You remember 7,000 chemicals. How does tobacco enter? One is direct through the mucosa. Second is, when a person smokes, some of it gets into the stomach by swallowing. And third is, it is absorbed across the alveolar epithelium. This mucosa means not only respiratory mucosa, also the mucosa of the gastric and esophageal mucosa also. Because of that only, it causes peptic ulcer, esophagitis, etc. So what are the diseases it causes? In the CVS, more than 5 million deaths per year. Why it is so? Because increased platelet aggregation. The platelet aggregation is promoted by tobacco. So this platelets aggregate, and they already, the endothelium will be damaged. Endotheliitis or vascular injury is caused by the tobacco, and the platelets adhere to it, and that forms the nidus for atherosclerosis development, thrombosis development, etc. So that is the main reason. Also, reduced oxygen supply. That is because of the carbon monoxide that is present in the hemoglobin, that leads to reduced blood supply to the myocardium. And due to all this, the person develops hypertension, coronary diseases, atherosclerosis, and myocardial infarction. Then in the respiratory tract is next, more than 3 million deaths per year. That is because of the inflammation caused to the respiratory tree, bronchial tree. Also, this tobacco smoke attracts WBCs. And because of that, inflammation is promoted. This causes COPDs and lung cancer. Other increased risks are hypercholesterolemia, cataract, the macular degeneration of the eye, then erectile dysfunction. As the person ages, the dysfunction occurs, and it is a promoter of rheumatoid arthritis and high risk to develop type 2 diabetes mellitus and reduced fertility. So what are the cancers that are being produced? Lung, larynx, you remember upper aerodigestive tract. So upper arrow means pharynx, larynx, bronchus, then digestive, esophagus, oral cavity. Okay, that is upper aerodigestive tract. So larynx, oral cavity, pharynx, esophagus. Then lips also, that is the oral cavity. Then lung, bladder, and kidney because of excretion. Then stomach, peptic ulcer and ulcers leading to that, pancreas, and also to a certain extent cervix. Then acute myeloid leukemia also. So what are the things that promote that? Polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. Then NNK. Then NNN. All these are chemicals that promote cancer. Then amino biphenyl to naphthalamine. This promotes the bladder cancer. Also liver and colon cancers also throughout. Okay, except bone and a few other things. Any cancer can be produced by tobacco smoke. So what does tobacco has to do with lung cancers? It has got a direct irritant effect. And the risk is increased directly proportional to the intensity of exposure. And it is called packers. What is a packer? The number of cigarettes, smoke or BDs, whatever it is, smoke person uses per day into number of years. So suppose a person is using 10 cigarettes per day for 10 years, then it is 10 into 10, 100 pack years, like that. So these people, when people who are working in asbestos and uranium mines, when they smoke, the risk is 10 times more. Okay, these are occupational hazards, asbestos and uranium workers. And these people, when they are, they run a higher risk for carcinogenesis and lung cancer. And when these people smoke, the risk is 10 times higher. So all this are lung cancer is mainly due to polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons and nitrosamines, also polonium-210. This is a radioactive material that is present in the tobacco. Why that is so? That is because cytochrome P oxidase, that enzyme, cytochrome oxidase enzymes are responsible for its metabolism. So during metabolism, some intermediate products are produced and they form DNA attacks. So this DNA attacks cause mutations. So in animal models and in human cancer, they found many mutations when in a smoke person who is been smoking, and in the tumor tissue also. What does maternal smoking do to the fetus? There is increased carboxyhemoglobin level. Because of that, intrauterine growth retardation. There is premature birth, abortion, delivery complication, and low birth weight. And sometimes stillbirth also. The baby dies immediately after birth. What is passive smoking? This is a secondhand smoke or environmental. A person in our family smokes, that affects all the rest in the family, especially the children. They end up with repeated bronchitis and asthma. And other adults, they run a risk of 1.3 times lung cancer, especially adenocarcinoma of the lung in females is due to male or somebody in the family is a smoker. And coronary atherosclerosis is more, and myocardial infarction. So how do we measure? How was that found? They measure, when you measure the blood levels of cotinine. What is cotinine? This is a metabolic product of nicotine. So this level is high in the family members or in the surrounding people who are living with a smoker. Second, so that is about tobacco, and we come to alcohol abuse. So we know that 50% of the Western world drink alcohol, and 5 to 10% have chronic alcoholism, and about 1 lakh death is caused. Mainly 50% is due to drunken driving, alcohol related homicide, suicide. You know, when a person drinks alcohol, he becomes stuporous, he doesn't know what to do, what he is doing. And then cirrhosis of the liver causes about 15%. Worldwide, 5.9% of the deaths are due to alcoholism, either direct or like this indirect deaths. So around 6%. So what is the legal definition for drunken driving is, when the blood level of alcohol is more than 80 milligram percent, it is a legal definition for drunken driving. What is social drinking? That within acceptable limit, and that is not alcohol abuse. What is alcohol abuse disorder? It is something addicted. The person has, it is a relapsing brain disease by impaired ability to stop or control alcohol use. Though he knows the social, occupational, and health consequences, the person cannot stop it or control the use of alcohol by something is addiction, relapsing brain disease. So how does alcohol gets metabolized? It is absorbed. When a person drinks alcohol, it is absorbed unaltered, just like that, by the stomach and the intestine. And it is distributed to all tissues according to the blood level. Less than 10% is excreted unchanged in urine, sweat, and breath. So the remaining 90% has to be metabolized. And some amount is exhaled, and that is also directly proportional to the blood level. This is responsible for this concept. With this concept only, the breath test is being developed. So when the blood alcohol level is high, the amount exhaled will be high. That is why they ask, they do the breath test to find out whether it is a drunken driving or not. So the drunken driving is 80%. The rate of metabolism affects the blood alcohol level. Maybe two people. In some people, the metabolism is very slow. So two people drink the same amount of alcohol. If one person has got a slow metabolism, his blood alcohol level may be high at a particular time. But the other person, if this metabolism is quite good, his blood level will be at the same point, his blood level may be very less. So chronic alcoholics tolerate up to 700 grams per person because they develop increased liver cytochrome P enzymes, group of enzymes. So this is how alcohol gets, this is a hepatocyte, liver cell. Okay. So main thing occurs in the cytoplasm, cytosol, within the cytosol. So alcohol is absorbed as such in the stomach and the intestine. It gets into the liver, and in the liver there is alcohol dehydrogenase. So this alcohol dehydrogenase converts it to acetaldehyde. This is the main mode of metabolism, and to some amount gets metabolized in the microsomes. There it uses cytochrome P group of enzymes. So here also the net product is acetaldehyde, and a little amount gets metabolized in the peroxisomes. There the catalase enzyme is used, and here also acetaldehyde is being formed. Okay, so cytosol uses alcohol dehydrogenase. In the microsome, cytochrome P enzymes. In the peroxisomes, it is the catalase. Okay, the acetaldehyde is being formed. This acetaldehyde is only very dangerous. The acetaldehyde should be converted to acetaldehyde dehydrogenase, okay, the enzyme, to acetic acid in the mitochondria. Remember, so cytosol, peroxisomes, microsomes, and mitochondria are involved. So in the mitochondria, acetaldehyde is converted to acetic acid. So when there is a problem in this conversion, the acetaldehyde level gets very high. Okay. Also, you remember, in the cytosol, the NAD is converted to reduced form during the process of this conversion. And in this microsomes, the when the cytochrome oxidase is involved, again this NADP plus is formed, and free radical is also formed. Also here, hydrogen peroxide is here converted to water. That is okay. And here also some amount of free radical is being formed. So this forms the metabolism, ethanol metabolism. What happens when this is converted to reduced form nicotine? This is getting reduced, NAD is reduced. Reduced NAD leads to fat accumulation within the hepatocytes. Fat gets accumulated. And increased NADH-NAD ratio causes metabolic acidosis. Okay, because this is increased and this is reduced, this ratio causes metabolic acidosis. Decreased ALDH. Where is ALDH? This occurs in 50% of the Asian population. So the metabolism of acetaldehyde to acetic acid is slowed down, very much slowed down. And because of that, the toxic symptoms occurs like flushing, tachycardia, hyperventilation. And metabolism with cytochrome P causes free radical formation, and that causes oxidation of the hepatocytes, the membrane. You remember the free radical injury, the membrane peroxidation and release of endotoxin from intestinal flora. It damages the intestinal flora, so endotoxins are released, as well as cytokines from the macrophages are released, that causes inflammatory reaction. So acute alcoholism, what does it do? In the CNS, it causes depression because now the subcortical structures are all depressed. Okay, they are all, there is depression of the centers, present over there. Then cortical motor intellectual behavior, you all know the person cannot walk, motor intellectual behavior, both are affected. He cannot walk properly, he cannot think properly, etc. Then lower medullary centers and cortical depression causes. When it is 200 milligram per deciliter, it causes drowsiness. At 300 stupor, more than that, coma and respiratory arrest, because the lower medullary centers get depressed. But whereas in chronic alcoholics, they can tolerate up to 700 milligram. In this is CNS, depression of the centers, subcortical structures, lower medullary centers, and cortical depression, leading to motor intellectual behavior is reduced, drowsiness, stupor, coma, and respiratory arrest. Then stomach, all of you know, it causes acute gastritis, ulceration. In the liver, what does it cause? We already said, there is fat accumulation, steatosis, fatty degeneration. You must have read in your cell injury. So, that is fat accumulation that leads on to hepatitis. Then, what will happen? Alcoholic hepatitis, cirrhosis, and then carcinoma of the liver. Then, in the pancreas, this you must remember. The person taking a heavy bout of alcohol suddenly gets up in the midnight with severe abdominal pain, it must be acute pancreatitis. It is a medical emergency and sometimes surgical emergency also, and the mortality is very, very high. The liver, already we said, hepatic steatosis, hepatitis, cirrhosis leading to carcinoma. This already I told you. What is varices? Varices are because of the cirrhosis, there is portohepatic anastomosis leading to esophageal varices, umbilical, around the umbilical cord, caput medusae, then hemorrhoids, etc. Vitamin B12 and energy are reduced. The vitamin B12, remember, so he develops large macrocytes, will be alcoholic people have macrocytic anemia, large RBCs, then peripheral neuropathy, and because B1 is deficient, Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome. In the heart, cardiac enlargement, myocardial infarction, and hypertension. Pancreas, we already told, acute pancreatitis, and repeated acute pancreatitis leads to chronic pancreatitis. What does it do in the reproductive system? Testicular atrophy and abortions. Also, what is fetal alcohol syndrome? When a mother during confinement, antenatal women consuming alcohol, especially in the first trimester and also throughout, it leads to growth retardation, mental retardation of the fetus, and birth defects, microcephaly, small head, facial dysmorphism, disproportionate nose, ear, like that, face is disproportionate. Then intrauterine growth retardation. What are the cancers it produces? Oral cavity, esophagus, liver, breast, and larynx. And whether it is acetaldehyde induced is a query, and acetaldehyde is said to produce DNA attacks, so it causes mutation, and a lot of studies has yet to be done. And when a person is a smoker and an alcoholic, these cancers have got a increased incidence. And now coming to lead. What is this? Flint water crisis. Anybody knows the history? in 2014, these people, Flint is an area, they were taking water from Detroit, and they changed the water from Flint River, their own river, water plant. So what happens is this water contains a lot of chloride. So from the lead pipe, this because of the increased chloride, the lead leached out and lead poisoning occurred. And many people came with lead intoxicity. So what is lead? Lead is a readily absorbed metal. Remember, it is readily absorbed. It's a metal. It binds to sulfhydryl groups in proteins. So it binds to proteins and interferes with calcium metabolism. So main thing is in the bone, blood, etc. That leads to hematologic, skeletal, bone, neurology, gastrointestinal, and renal toxicity. So which system is left out? Only respiratory and genitourinary. All the others are involved. Also, genitourinary involvement is also there. So what are the sources? How do we get lead in toxicity? By contaminated air, food or water. This house pains, when we have very low cost pains that has got lot of lead, and this flake, it will fall in flakes in the old houses, that will cause contamination of the food, water, air and soil. Also the petrol, then batteries, also people, occupational hazard, people who are working in mines, foundries, spray painting, manufacturing of battery, pigments, car radiators, tin cans, etc. These people are exposed when they work. And children are more prone to be affected by lead toxicity because they absorb more than 50% lead from the food, whereas adults absorb only 15%. This is one thing. Second thing is they have a blood-brain barrier permeability. Third is their bones are not united, ossified, and because of that. So lead blood levels in children living in homes containing lead-based paint is high. And they absorb more amount of lead. The permeability of the blood-brain barrier. So, lead gets into the brain and causes damage. And their bone, they have developing bone and teeth. So, lead is taken up by that. So, it competes with already in the definition we saw. It interferes with calcium metabolism. So, it competes with calcium and binds phosphates. And the most worst part is it has got a half-life of 20 to 30 years. So it will be there, not going at all. So 5 to 10% will remain in the blood, remainder in the soft tissue. And the Center for Disease Control says if the level, blood level is 5 microgram per deciliter, we have to explore where they are getting exposed, and that should be limited. So in what are the adverse health effects in children? So if it is up to 5 microgram, there is developmental toxicity. So decreased IQ level, intellectual level, academic disabilities, attention-related behaviors and antisocial behaviors. When it goes to 10, there is delayed puberty, decreased growth and hearing. And as the level increases, there is decreased calcium homeostasis. So, decreased vitamin D metabolism and that leads to all the bone and teeth developments, developmental defects. Increased level of erythrocyte protoporphyrin. That I'll tell you how that happens. Then increased nerve conduction velocity. Because of that, the person gets psychosis. Then psychosis. Then schizophrenia kind of symptoms, as well as then increased vitamin D metabolism, increased risk of hypertension in adulthood, and abdominal colic, anemia. What kind of anemia? I'll tell you. Nephropathy. Why? I'll tell you. Encephalopathy, and when it reaches more, death. And in the adults, it is already we saw occupational or non-occupational. And this is in children. And when their fusion is affected in the adults, it causes chronic tubulointerstitial disease of the kidney. So causing chronic kidney disorder. Abdominal, severe abdominal colic. Then peripheral nerves, there is demyelination. Myelin fibers are removed. Because of that, they get peripheral neuropathy. The blood anemia and the sideroblastic anemia. I'll show you that. In the brain, they get memory loss, headache. In children, of course, we learned. And in the gingiva, there will be lead line. So what is the brain? What are the changes in the brain? It mainly occurs in children and it is irreversible. Remember, if there is little bit of demyelination in adults, it can be reversible. Some amount of mental disturbances are reversible in the adults, whereas in children it is irreversible. So this is mild to massive and lethal. It causes edema in the brain and necrosis. You know necrosis, no? They have the neurons. So what are the things affected? The sensory disturbances, motor disturbances, intellectual disturbances, and psychologic disturbance. So blindness can occur, psychosis, seizures, that is, and coma. And if the mother is exposed to high level of lead, then the fetal brain will be affected. So peripheral demyelination leads to wrist drop and foot drop. So this is, you cannot do the nerves are affected, demyelinated. So wrist cannot be, extension is not possible. Same way in the foot drop. And what kind of anemia? Sideroblastic anemia. Why this is happening? Because two things happen in with the RBC. One is the iron cannot be incorporated into the heme component. That is why we said this protoporphyrin, somewhere it was here. Yeah. Increased level of erythrocyte protoporphyrin. That is because the heme cannot, iron cannot be incorporated into the heme. So because of that, it is like iron deficiency anemia, microcytic hypochromic anemia. But how do we find out? There will be punctate basophilia. Like this, you get some blue dots within the RBC. And in the bone marrow, you get sideroblasts. When you do iron stain, the ring sideroblast around the nucleus of the nucleated RBCs, you get iron storage within the mitochondria. It interferes with aminolevulinic acid dehydratase and delta ferrochelatase. And little bit of hemolysis. That is because in the membrane, the potassium-sodium dependent ATPase is inhibited. Because of that, there is some amount of hemolysis also happening. In the gastrointestinal, kidney and bone, what happens? In the GIT, there is severe abdominal pain. The kidney, it is the proximal convoluted tubule is damaged. So within the nucleus of the cells, tubular cells, epithelium, lead inclusions are present. And that will cause chronic kidney disease. And remodeling of the calcified cartilage occurs. That leads to delaying of the mineralization and you get areas in the X-ray called lead lines. Also in the gingiva, you get blue lines. They are also called, this blue color, can you make out? They are also called lead lines. Now coming to radiation injury. Hazards of radiation. What is radiation? It's an energy that travels in the form of waves or high-speed particles. There is two types, ionizing radiation, non-ionizing radiation. What is the difference between the two is, this can emit that electron, this can displace electron from the atom. This non-ionizing, though there is a vibration, the electron cannot be separated in this non-ionizing ones. And ionizing ones are X-ray, gamma ray, high energy neutron, alpha particle, beta particle. So this is of great medical importance. We cannot practice medicine without all this, especially for diagnosis and for therapy. For cancers, etc., you need this gamma rays, high energy neutron, alpha, beta particle, X-ray, and for CT scan, etc., for diagnostic purposes, we need that. We need the great importance in medicine. At the same time, this is harmful. So repeated X-rays, repeated CT, that is not advisable. Non-ionizing waves are infrared, microwave, sound wave, UV wave. And what are the units? I'm not going into the details of units. Curie, all of you know, lot of work has been done by Madame Curie. So Curie, Gray and Siebert. These are the units of radiation. What are the determinants? How do you measure the injury? How does the injury happen? One is rate of delivery. So if a small amount of radiation is given continuously also, it is more harmful. If large amount is given at intermittent intervals, so in that time, there is a gap or time given for recovery. So the rate of delivery is important. So continuous delivery is dangerous than intermittent delivery. That is why even for cancer therapy, they give radiation for 5 days, then they give rest for 2 days for the normal surrounding cells to recover. Okay? Then field size is important. High dose for a small area is okay, but even small dose for a wide area, for the whole body radiation, though it is of a small dose, but wide field is used, that is dangerous. And cell proliferation. The radiation mainly affects the cells which are dividing. So what are the cells which are most commonly affected? The blood cells, of course, then the mucosa that keep dividing, then you have the lymph node. These are the areas which are most commonly affected, whereas the muscle, brain, etc. are not much affected. Then the hypoxia. So if there is that area where the is affected by radiation, the vessels are not good. So the oxygen or blood supply is not proper, then the recovery cannot happen. Because of that, hypoxia increases the adverse effects of radiation. Similarly, the vascular damage also increases the adverse effects of radiation. So what are the determinants? Rate of delivery, the field size, the cells proliferation, hypoxia, and the vascular damage. So what does ionizing radiation do? So here, free radical injury, you must have read in your first chapter, cell injury. So direct effect is the ionizing radiation directly causes DNA damage. Indirect effect is it causes radiolysis of water. Have you heard of it? In free radical injury. Okay. Reactive oxygen species, etc. So free radicals are formed that causes DNA damage. So two things can happen. One is their repair can happen if their repair, the DNA repair and tissue reconstitution, tissue becomes normal. That is, repair is taking place. If there is no repair, what two things again can happen? One is cell division is being inhibited and cell death occurs, cell injury, cell death, irreversible injury. Second is, if it is damaging the DNA and not causing cell death, two things. If it is in the fetus or germ cells, it causes congenital anomalies, teratogenesis. If it is in the fetus developing or causing the germ cell, the teratogenesis, congenital anomalies. If it otherwise in the adult cell, it can cause carcinogenesis. It can cause carcinogenesis. 1 minute. So what are the effects? So in the blood and bone marrow, cytopenias, anemia, lympho, and you must remember, usually in other things, cytopenia is mainly neutropenia, but here lymphopenia predominates than granulocytopenia. So all the cells will be reduced. In the gonads, testes, spermatogonia, spermatid, sperm, everything is destroyed, also ovaries. Testes is more affected than the ovaries because testes is exposed outside. Then atrophy and fibrosis of the gonads occur. In the GIT, there is mucosal injury, ulceration, fibrosis. Then lymph nodes. Well, lymph nodes contain lymphocytes. So lymphocytes are dividing. So there is lymphopenia. So what happens to lymph nodes? Atrophy. They become very small. Tissue loss and later fibrosis. In the lungs, edema, acute respiratory distress syndrome and fibrosis. In the skin, erythema, redness and edema, pigmentation is reduced, also skin cancers. You might be knowing that albinism, the melanin DNA repair cannot be done. Those people are more exposed and to when the UV light, etc., they are prone to get basal cell carcinoma. So more often the cancers are more common. In the adult, brain is resistant because it's not dividing. Okay. And embryonic tissues, when in the fetus, the neural development is delayed. So bone marrow atrophy, hypoplasia, leukemia. In the skin, erythema, atrophy of the epidermis and fibrosis. In the heart, interstitial fibrosis, but not much. In the lung, there is edema, endothelium, epithelial cell death, and fibrosis, cancer. GIT, edema, mucosal ulcer, and causing strictures, cancer. Liver, cirrhosis, kidney, atrophy, fibrosis, everywhere fibrosis. What is fibrosis? You all know, because of the repair. Okay, cells are dying, replaced by scar tissue. Thymus and lymph node lymphoma can occur. In the cellular level, there are structural changes in the chromosomes. What kind of changes? Deletion, translocation, fragmentation. What are the nuclear changes? Nucleus swells, condense, clumping. And apoptosis. Apoptosis, all of you know. Then cytoplasmic changes, cellular injury. So cytoplasm swells, mitochondria swells, degeneration of endoplasmic reticulum, all the ribosomes ooze out, and cellular swelling occurs. Giant cells, pleomorphic nuclei, cell death. Then vascular changes occur and fibrosis, repair by fibrosis. And DNA is the most important target of radiation. Okay, double-stranded bands are being formed. So pyrimidine dimers. So either cell death occurs. If it is cell death, fine. Otherwise, it proliferation of cell death occurs, dysplasia, and then cancer cell with because of mutation. Children are more affected, and you know the second malignancy. What is second malignancy? When a child gets, you know, childhood tumors, leukemias, Hodgkin's lymphoma, neuroblastoma, etc. When they get radiation for one cancer, after some time, if they are cured of that cancer and they are living, after 10 years, 15 years, they develop second malignancy. That because of the radiation. So therapy-induced malignancy. In Hiroshima, Nagasaki, still leukemia, thyroid, breast and lung cancers are common. In Chernobyl, you know, thyroid cancers are more. In Marshall Island, there was a nuclear leak out. There, leukemia and birth defects are present. And people who get radiation therapy for Hodgkin's lymphoma, they are prone to get myeloid leukemia, myelodysplastic syndrome, and solid organ tumors as second malignancy. When you take two CT scans, there is a measurable increase of leukemia and brain tumor. Not only for your exam, also in your practice, avoid radiation, related diagnostic services as much you can. Radiation to the chest and for something else, for skin cancer or something, will lead on to breast cancer. And uranium miners, people who work with radon, polonium, etc., develop lung cancer. And what does it do with hematopoietic and lymphoid tissue? Lymphopenia, shrinkage of lymph node and spleen, dose-dependent aplasia of the marrow, so cytopenias. And high doses kill the stem cells, causing aplastic anemia. You remember in aplastic anemia, I said radiation. And diseases of childhood, I will tell you only two neoplasms, malignant neoplasms. Shall I continue? Two neoplasms which are important for exam point of view. There won't be time for to cover everything. Okay. One of you can tell whether to
cover. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So here, common malignant neoplasms of infancy and childhood are, you remember there is small blue cell tumors. Small blue cell tumors. They are blastomas. So what are the blastomas? Retinoblastoma, then neuroblastoma in the sympathetic nervous system. Then this is nephroblastoma or Wilms tumor, hepatoblastoma in the liver, These are the four blastomas. Then you have rhabdomyosarcoma with a skeletal muscle, teratoma, all the elements, three elements, epithelial, mesenchyme, all the elements will be present, teratoma, then some CNS tumor. So in 0 to 4 years, all these tumors along with leukemia can happen. At 5 to 9 years, the incidence of Wilms tumor is reduced, but that can occur the tumors along with Ewing's sarcoma, a tumor in the diaphysis of the bone that occurs along with lymphoma. At 10 to 14 years, the incidence of retinoblastoma and neuroblastoma is reduced, but others are present, and osteogenic sarcoma, thyroid carcinomas, and Hodgkin's lymphoma are common. So here, retinoblastoma, Ewing's sarcoma mainly, nephroblastoma, and rhabdomyosarcoma, neuroblastoma, lymphoma, and leukemia, and brain tumors. So neuroblastoma and Wilms tumor I'll cover. Neuroblastoma occurs 1 in 7,000 live births, and median age at diagnosis is 18 months. So where does this occur? 40% occurs in the adrenal medulla. Adrenal medulla, 40%. And 25% in the paravertebral sympathetic nervous system. So it will be in the abdomen, paravertebral sympathetic nervous system in the abdomen. And around 15% in the posterior mediastinum. The sites are important. When a small child with adrenal tumor, you suspect neuroblastoma. Same way, abdominal tumor, paravertebral region, suspect neuroblastoma. Posterior mediastinal tumor, suspect neuroblastoma. Others can be cervical, other regions are cervical, sympathetic ganglion, anywhere. And it is sporadic. So sporadic means just like that it is forming. In most of the people, 1 to 2% has got a familial incidence. So what is the mutation is ALK gene, that is anaplastic lymphoma kinase. ALK gene, anaplastic lymphoma kinase gene. In familial, there is a germline mutation. What is the difference between germline and somatic mutation? Germline mutation is when the fetus is developing itself, that mutation is present. So you get a mutation in all the cells of the body. Any cell you take, even lymphocytes are enough to find out the mutation. Whereas somatic mutation, only in the tumor tissue there will be mutation. You take the other tissue, like some other tissue or some other blood tissue or something, the mutation will not be there. So sporadic, it is a somatic mutation is seen in 10% of the cases, whereas in the familial, it is a germline mutation. And this tumor metastasizes via hematogenous as well as lymphatic. So it spreads to bone, bone marrow, liver, lymph node, and skin. So grossly, it can be a very small one, not identified, like in situ. So this in situ tumor may regress by itself without any treatment. It goes unnoticed. So in an adult, you find small calcified areas in the adrenal. He must have had a small neuroblastoma that regressed by itself. Or it can be more than 1 kg like this. So it can be infiltrative also. And it is soft, gray, tan, necrosis, hemorrhage, bleeding, and small spotty calcifications can be present. Histology. You remember, they are small, small round blue cells. You remember, small round blue cells, small primitive cells. Can you identify the cell border? All the cells are equal or not? Not equal. So pleomorphism, morphology is not equal. Pleo, different. The cell border, can you identify? You have to describe a cell from outside to inside. Then you won't be forgetting anything. So first, tell about the tumor, how is it present? Small primitive cell, they vary in size and shape. And individual cell, they have a poor cell border. The cytoplasm is very scanty. You are not, all blue, nucleus only you are seeing. Are you seeing the cytoplasm? No. So scanty cytoplasm. Nucleus is dark, this blue. And background, what are these materials? They are fibrillary materials. Eosinophilic fibrillary material called neutrophil. And what is this? Around the neutrophil, the cells are situated in a rosette form around the neutrophil. What is this rosette in neuroblastoma called? Former right pseudo rosette. This is not a true rosette. This is a pseudo false rosette, pseudo rosette. Okay. So immunohistochemistry for neuron specific enolase and FOX2B. This you remember, immunohistochemistry for neuron specific enolase and FOX2B are positive like this. Clinically, how does the patient present with abdominal mass? Small children, abdominal mass, fever, weight loss. Little older kids, bony pain, GI symptom. Why GI symptom? That big tumor pressing on the GIT or the paravertebral area tumors pressing on the GIT. Then RS symptoms. Hematogenous lymphatic spread, I told you. Cutaneous, lung, liver, bone marrow. Then catecholamines are elevated in the blood because this tumor secretes catecholamines. And their metabolic products are vanillin mandelic acid and vanillin mandelic acid. Both are elevated. Then you will be seeing MYCN amplification status. So this MYCN is present in the 11th chromosome and you see like this, this fish. Fluorescent in situ hybridization, this red signal show amplification. So here it is not amplified. They are double only, but here it is amplified. Same way, you can make out a little bigger chromosome with red signal here. This is a cytogenetics. This is a G-banding technology, karyotyping, and this is FISH, MYCN amplification status. What are the prognostic features? What are the favorable prognostic features? Staging 1, 2A, 2B, 4S are good prognosis, 3 and 4 are bad, and age less than 18 months, good. More than 18 months, unfavorable. Histology. When you get schwannoma cells in the stroma, in the background, what do we see? Like this neutrophil. Among here, if you find some Schwann cells, okay, or gangliocytes, then that is favorable. If it is absent, it is not favorable. Mitosis and nuclear fragmentation, karyorexis. If it is less than 200, favorable. If the mitosis or nuclear fragmentation is more, of course, cells are dividing fast when mitosis are more. that is unfavorable. DNA, if there is hyperdiploidy or triploidy, it is favorable. Near diploid, if it is almost normal, it is unfavorable. N-mic, not amplified, is favorable. If it is amplified, unfavorable. Chromosome, 1p loss and 11q loss are unfavorable. 17q gain is unfavorable. So remember, chromosome, 1p loss, 11q loss, 17q gain, if it is present, is unfavorable. Then molecular, TERC A expression and TERC B expression. TERC A is good, TERC B is bad. Telomerase, if it is highly expressed, it is bad. And staging, of course, clinical staging, you read from the book, it is very simple. And now coming to the last, Wilms tumor, otherwise called nephroblastoma. 1 in 10,000 children are affected and 95% occur before 10 years. In 5 to 10% of them, both kidneys are affected. And from Wilms tumor, many things were learned. Malformations are associated with neoplasia. And in Wilms tumor, how the kidney developed, the organogenesis, same way this nephroblastoma or Wilms tumor also developed, same way. But there is an aberration. There is a double hit theory. When there is a tumor suppressor gene is involved, two times when it is hit, the tumor developed. And how does the premalignant lesions develop? Treatment outcome is very good. All these are learned. So what are the malformations? Wegener syndrome. What is a Wegener syndrome? So this WT1 gene is present in 11p at 13. 11th chromosome, short arm at region 13. 13. So it has got axis area, tail area, centralized area, etc. So whether this is mutated or this is mutated or the whole thing is mutated is our concern. When everything is mutated, there is a risk of Wilms tumor. When this alone is mutated, only aniridia presents, no risk of Wilms tumor. That is why 33% run the risk of developing Wilms tumor. What is Wegener syndrome? W stands for Wilms tumor. A is for aniridia. The iris is absent. Then G stands for genitourinary abnormalities. R is for mental retardation. But nowadays we don't say mental retardation. We tell intellectual disability. Okay? So this has got a 33% risk. Second malformation is Dennis-Drash syndrome. So here this WT1 gene, this is inactivated, biallelic inactivation. Both alleles, it are inactivated. So there is paternal, maternal, both are inactivated. So here Dennis-Drash syndrome has got what? Wilms tumor. Then pseudo-hermaphroditism. Male pseudo-hermaphroditism in the genitalia and diffuse mesangial sclerosis in the kidney. Kidney, renal, mesangium, there is scarring. So kidney disorder. Kidney is being chronic kidney disease, and there is a risk of forming a germ cell tumor of the testis. Okay, this is Dennis-Drash syndrome by allelic inactivation of WT1 gene. The third malformation is Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome. So here again 11p, but it is WT2. So here 15.5, that is 13. WT1 is 13. Here it is 15.5. Here, because this area codes for insulin like growth factor 2. So this insulin growth factor 2 causes all megaly, enlargement of the organs, macroglossia, tongue is large, umbilical hernia, because the muscle is weak and the organs are all inside, abdominal organs are all enlarged, there is umbilical hernia, and there this omphalocele, this will come outside also, outside the abdominal cavity. And also hemihypertrophy, one side, one leg or one arm or one side of the body is enlarged. This is Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome, WT2 gene and insulin growth factor causing enlargement of the organs and Wilms tumor. So how does Wilms tumor occur? So WT1, Dennis-Drash syndrome and Wegener syndrome, or you know, you all of you know TP53 tumor suppressor gene, or FWT1, this is mutated. And with Wiedemann syndrome, WT2 or loss of interest, these genes are involved. So now this is a normal kidney. So how was normal kidney being developed? So from the normal, what happens is WT1 inactivated, or WT2 with other mutation occurs, this embryonic nest should go off when it becomes normal. But when this embryonic nest persists, you call it persistent nephrogenic rest. Okay, when these embryonic rests are present, they develop into Wilms tumor when there is P53 inactivation or loss of heterogeneity of 16q, 1p or some other genes. Have you understood? So this is the embryonic kidney where some nephrogenic rests are present. And these should be lost when it becomes normal kidney. When this persists because of WT1 inactivation or WT2 or loss of heterozygosity of other genes, then the embryonic kidney with nephrogenic rests will form. Persistent nephrogenic rests are present. This will develop into Wilms tumor when there is P53 inactivation and loss 16q1p others are involved. So this is a double hit theory. Initially I told you WT1 and WT2 are involved. So grossly it is a large tumor. This is a kidney. You can see the renal vein, left kidney. So the kidney remains, you can identify the kidney. The kidney is dwarfed. That means it's compressed, dwarfed. That is not infiltrated. Can you see the capsule, well capsulated? The kidney is being dwarfed or compressed. The tumor compresses the kidney and it is well encapsulated or circumscribed. Large single mass, solitary, and it is bilateral in 10% of the cases. Cut surface is soft, homogeneous. Sometimes small amount of hemorrhage can occur, but it is not common. Microscopically, you have to write this three. Triphasic combination, blastemal, stromal, epithelial. Remember, blastema, that is the primitive nephrogenic rest, then stromal cells, then epithelial cells. So there is a transition of mesenchyme to epithelium during the development of kidney. When the nephrogenic rests are persistent, you have this blastemal and the stromal components along with some epithelial elements. So how does the blastemal component looks like? They are the sheets of small blue cells, like neuroblastoma cells, you describe small blue cells. Then what is the epithelial cell? That is the abortive glomeruli, tubule or glomeruli. It is not functional. It is abortive, but it resembles a tubule or glomeruli, but it is not functional. Then what is the stromal component? It is a spindle cell. It can be fibroblast, myxoid or skeletal muscle. Sometimes you find cartilage also. So spindle cell, stroma, blastema, stroma, epithelial. Blastema, small blue cells, epithelial, abortive tubule or glomeruli, stroma, fibroblast, myxoid, skeletal muscle. Then anaplasia. They are not equal. All are looking different. And TP53 mutation can also be seen. That's all. Metastasis, bilateral in some of the cases, and with treatment, the outcome is good. Other things are not able to cover. Shall we close? Any doubt? Any doubt? Any doubt?
No, ma'am.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.